Welcome to Davie United Methodist Church. It is April 26, 2020, and I am Pastor Scott Didrikson, and we are blessed and excited that you're joining us for our online worship service on this third Sunday of Easter. Let us start with a few announcements.
We will continue to stream church worship online. It will be posted on Sunday mornings. Service will be posted on our website at www.davieumc.com under the worship tab, or you can go to YouTube or to Facebook on Sunday mornings.
You can also use the Davie UMC website for your online giving, tithes, and offerings. Just click on the website and either scroll down at about middle of the page to the orange giving tab or look under I'm new and go to the giving section under that. Thank you to all of those that are continuing to tithe to the church. Your faithfulness is a blessing to all of us. And if you haven't yet, please make sure that you connect through that giving button on the website. Or you can mail your checks to the church office at 6500 Southwest 47th Street, Davie, Florida, 33314. Thank you for your faithfulness and continuing to support the church and God's mission and plan for us in our community and the world.
We will be having Sunday school online at 10 a.m. every Sunday. Please download Zoom to your PC or download the app to join the group. You can also join Wednesday night Bible study at 7 p.m. on Zoom. Please check your email for the link to Zoom or contact the church office.
And finally, we will be having Thursday night devotions on Facebook Live at 7 p.m. Please join me as we continue to go deeper into the scriptures each week. May God bless you and keep you safe in this time of separation and the virus. Let us go into service with a word of prayer.
Glorious Lord of life, by the mighty resurrection of your Son, you overcame the old order of sin and death to make all things new in him. Grant that we who celebrate with joy Christ rising from the dead may be raised from the death of sin to the life of righteousness. Through him who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Psalm 116. I love the Lord because he has heard my voice and my supplications, because he inclined his ear to me. Therefore I will call on him as long as I live. The snares of death encompassed me. The pangs of Sheol laid hold on me. I suffered distress and anguish. Then I called on the name of the Lord. O Lord, I pray, save my life. Gracious is the Lord and righteous. Our God is merciful. The Lord protects the simple. When I was brought low, he saved me. Return, O my soul, to your rest, for the Lord has dealt bountifully with you. For you have delivered my soul from death, my eyes from tears, my feet from stumbling. I walked before the Lord in the land of the living. I kept my faith, even when I said, I am greatly afflicted. I said in my consternation, everyone is a liar. What shall I return to the Lord for all his bounty to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his faithful ones. O Lord, I am your servant. I am your servant, the child of your servant girl. You have loosed my bonds. I will offer you a thanksgiving sacrifice and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. In the courts of the house of the Lord, in your midst, O Jerusalem, praise the Lord.
weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. Darkness may fall, but won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. My God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. 'Cause the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to the Lord. Oh, there's power in the mighty name of Jesus. Every war he wages, he will win. I'm not backing down from any giant, 'cause I know how this story ends. Yes, I know how this story ends. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. 'Cause the battle belongs to the Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. 'Cause the battle belongs to the Lord. You take what the enemy gets for evil, and you turn it for good. Yes, you turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. Yes, you turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. Yes, you turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you take it for good. And you turn it for good. Weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. Oh, my God will never fail. Yes, my God will never fail. My God will never fail.
1 Peter chapter 1, verse 17 through 25, NRSV. If you invoke as the Father the one who judges all people impartially according to their deeds, live in reverent fear during the time of your exile. You know that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your ancestors, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of the Lamb, without defect or blemishes. He was destined before the foundation of the world, but was revealed at the end of the ages for your sake. Through him, you have come to trust in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are set on God. Now that you have purified your soul by your obedience to the truth, so that you have genuine mutual love, love one another deeply from the heart. You have been born anew, not of perishable, but imperishable seeds, through the living and enduring word of God. For all flesh is like grass, and all its glory like the flower of grass. The grass withers, and the flower falls, but the word of the Lord endures forever. That word is the good news that was announced to you. May the Lord bless the reading of his holy word.
Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. His cornerstone, his solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, his gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross where Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. The cross, his body lay, light of the world in darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again, and as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with his precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me, from life's first cry to final spread, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man, can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. Here in the power of Christ, I'll stand.
As we go into our time of prayer, we continue to pray for other churches in our community. This week we are praying for Miramar United Methodist Church and Pastor David Range. When I spoke to Pastor Range, he asked us to pray for their food pantry, that they continue to receive donations so that they can support those in their community that are at the biggest risk at this time during the virus. They are also asking that we pray that they receive their loan from the Paycheck Protection Program so they are able to continue to pay their staff at their preschool. We want to continue to lift up Pastor David and Miramar this week, especially in this time of the virus and the shutdown. Let us go to God in prayer. We come to the table of the Lord this day, not sure that we dare to believe in his presence with us. We hear the words of institution. This is my body. This is my blood given for you, poured out for you, that you may find forgiveness. And yet we still have doubts. We still have fears in our lives. We want to believe. We need to believe. For it is too easy for the empty promises of this world to dazzle our eyes. And so we come to you, Lord, with all of our fears and doubts,
our joys and sorrows, our longings and dreams. We bring these to you in hope that you will hear our prayers and respond to our cries. We bring to you the names of those whom we love, for whom issues of loneliness, pain, suffering, grief, and loss seem to abound and overcome. We bring to you the names of people who have rejoiced in newfound faith, who have reconciled with loved ones, who have survived tragedy and sorrow, who are happy, and we want to dance in celebration for their good fortune. Hear us, heal us, bless us, O Lord. We ask these things in the name of the one who was raised, that we might too have eternal life, as we pray the prayer he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Jesus loves me. This I know. For the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong. Tell
Luke 24:13-35. Now on the same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed, in word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hope that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all of this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and they did not find his body there. And they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, and they did not see him. Then he said to them, 'Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things, then enter into his glory?' Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, 'Stay with us, because it is almost evening, and the day is now nearly over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?' The same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, 'The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon.' Then they told what had happened on the road and how he had made known to them in the breaking of the bread." May the Lord bless this reading of his holy word.
As we look at these scriptures today, and especially at this Luke 24 Emmaus story, the story of the two disciples walking to the town of Emmaus and Jesus joining them. And as they walked along, Jesus and the disciples discussed what had transpired in Jerusalem with the crucifixion and the resurrection. This story is especially relevant for us as we were getting prepared for the Walk to Emmaus ministry that would have occurred this weekend for the men's walk and next weekend for the women's walk. Those walks have been postponed, obviously, because of the shutdown due to the virus. We do not know of the new dates as of yet, but if you were attending or serving on those walks, please continue to keep the walks in your prayers. I know that these walks are ordained by God to bring each of us that experience it closer to God. And so I know that one day soon we'll be able to do these walks, and those of you who are getting prepared to go on them, continue to pray and discern where God is calling you in this moment. We are also looking at this scripture today in the context of what we are experiencing in this world of the shutdown because of the virus. And I think the one word that a lot of us are feeling and experiencing is that word fear. Fear, it seems, is all around us. It is inundating our society, our news, the things that our politicians are talking to us about. It just feels like we are surrounded in this bubble of fear. And I know that even us Christians, those of us who walk in faith, are struggling in this moment with fear.
And I believe that this scripture and the 1 Peter scripture and the Psalms 116 scripture all explain and help us to understand where God is calling us, those of us who are living lives of faith, to deal with and live in a world that is just inundated with this fear. So let us first dive into this Luke chapter 24 scripture, starting at verse 15. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" So the disciples continue to tell Jesus about the events in Jerusalem, about the crucifixion of their Lord, and about how the women went to the tomb and they found it empty. But they had reported that they had seen angels that had told them that Jesus had risen and that they had hope that Jesus was the Messiah. But you could tell from the beginning of these verses that they were sad. In other translations, it actually says they were walking along looking sad. And so we can tell that they have hope, but they probably don't necessarily have faith or belief that Jesus had actually returned from the dead, that he had been raised up as he had told them he would be. And so we find these disciples walking along with Jesus, not being able to know or see that it is Jesus with them, but telling this story from a place of probably unbelief or unfaithfulness in the fact that Jesus had come back. And so Jesus responds to them in verse 25 through 27. After hearing this story of what had happened in Jerusalem, he says to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory? Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all of the scriptures." I believe that we see this sadness that the disciples have as they're walking along is actually a symptom of their unbelief, of them questioning whether or not Jesus is truly the Messiah, if whether or not any of this is actually real. And honestly, I think that in this moment in our context, we could separate the word sadness here for the word fear. I believe many of us who are Christians are walking through this moment with great fear in our hearts and in our lives. We are struggling mightily with fear. I can hear it, I can see it, I can feel it when I speak to people or even see other pastors or other Christians doing live streams on the internet. There is an anxiety of this situation that it feels like it's overpowering us to the extent that we aren't actually walking with faith, we're walking in fear. And I know these are tough words, and before I get deeper into this, first of all, I am not advocating or telling you to live outside of the recommendations of what we are supposed to be doing in society. I'm not telling you to be unsafe or to go out without your masks on, or if you're sick or if you're unhealthy or you're elderly, you should probably stay at home as much as you have to or much as you possibly can. I'm not telling you to live life in a way that will put you at risk, but there's a difference from being careful to being fearful. And I believe that this whole world
This whole situation is just, it's just saturated in fear. We are being told that we should be afraid of even being next to or near another human being. And it is coming from all parts of our society, from the media, from the people in Hollywood, our politicians. And so it is difficult for us to escape this fear, especially as believers and as Christians. But I truly believe that the scriptures and God has something to say about how we live in moments of chaos and fear. 1 Peter chapter 1, 17 through 19. If you invoke as Father the one who judges all people impartially according to their deeds, live in reverent fear during the time of your exile. You know that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your ancestors, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without defect or blemish. We see in this scripture of 1 Peter, Peter telling us to be in reverent fear as we live in relationship with God. But he doesn't say irrational fear. And I believe what he means by reverent fear here is that we have to live according to God's rules and calling for us, that we are not supposed to live outside of that just because we have been ransomed by the blood of Christ. But notice it says that we are ransomed not with perishable things like silver or gold, things of the world, but we are ransomed by the imperishable, by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. That we are saved not through the world's ways, but we are saved through God's ways. And that because of that, we should be living in a different way. And we need to look at what the scriptures, what the word of God has to say about fear. And as I was thinking about this idea of being fearful in this time, I started to look up different scriptures that talked about fear and especially how we as Christians are supposed to live in it. So we're going to go through multiple scriptures. And we are going to start in Isaiah chapter 41, verse 10. Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be afraid, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my victorious right hand. Then in Psalm chapter 56, verse 3, when I am afraid, I put my trust in you. Then Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 through 7. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. John chapter 14, verse 27. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7. For God did not give us a spirit of cowardice, but rather a spirit of power and of love and of self-discipline. And then in 1 John chapter 4, verse 18, and this may be a difficult one for us to hear. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, for fear has to do with punishment. And whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. And finally, Psalms chapter 23, verse 4, and we have all heard this before. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. So normally I don't like to just read single verses or snippets of scripture, But here in this moment, I wanted us to look at many different books of the Bible and different places in Scripture where we are talking about fear and how we, especially as the faithful, are supposed to experience fear and to live in the world and in moments of fear. And I believe the theme that we see here is pretty consistent. And that is that God is calling us as believers to live past the fear. That we are supposed to have faith, a faith that overrides the fear of the world, the fear of death, the fear of even this virus. That we are supposed to live with joy. We see this with the psalmist in Psalm 116. This psalmist has gone through very difficult times in their life, but they are not living in fear. They have a joyful thanksgiving that they are thankful for God's blessing in their life, that they will not be overrun by fear, but they are looking and living life with a faith, a joyful thanksgiving. And I believe that God is calling us to that in this moment as well. And for those of you who are anxious or living with a great deal of fear, I am not trying to take away from your feelings or belittle how you feel in this moment. But my question to you is this: how are you living in this moment? Where are you investing and spending most of your time? Even in this moment of separation where you are probably stuck in your house, how are you spending most of your time? Are you spending it by watching the television and listening to the news and waiting breathlessly for that next death count or the next announcement of how many people have contracted the virus? Or are you watching to see who's not following the rules and who is? And are you getting angry by people not doing things exactly the way you want them to do it? Are you being honestly run by fear? Are you becoming a slave to what the media and the news is talking about each night? Is that how you're spending all of your time? Or are you spending it with God? Are you spending it in the Scriptures? As we look to this passage in Luke chapter 24, we notice that as Jesus responds to the disciples, the first thing Jesus does is Jesus goes through the Scriptures. Jesus explains the Scriptures to them. They are spending time talking about the Scriptures, about what God was telling them, about who the Messiah was and what the Messiah would do. Sounds a little familiar to a Bible study, doesn't it? Sounds like they were doing a Bible study as they walked from Jerusalem to that town of Emmaus. And so my question to you, especially those of you who are inundated with fear in your lives right now, are you spending your time in the Scriptures? Are you spending your time, even though we're not able to meet one-on-one, are you joining us in the Bible studies or the Sunday school classes? Are you listening to other online streaming services and churches that are explaining what the Scriptures are talking about? Are you listening and being a part of it? Are you sharing your life with other Christians in this moment? Or are you just wrapped up in the news reports? The second thing that happened in this story is as they get to the home that they were traveling to in the town of Emmaus, and Jesus was going to go on his way, the two disciples did something very interesting. They invited Jesus to come and stay the night there. They invited Jesus to come in with their family and to be with them, to live with them for the night. And I believe it's a metaphor for our own decision in this moment. Are we inviting Jesus into our lives right now? Are we allowing Jesus and God to be the main focus of our life and of our family's lives? Or again, are we more focused on the media and the world and what the world is telling us and what the world is trying to make us feel or get us to experience, which is fear, I believe? Or are we wrapping ourselves with the love, the peace, the hope, and the faith that is Jesus Christ, that through Jesus' death and resurrection, we are given the ultimate hope? We're given hope that overrides death, that defeats death. God has given us a hope and a faith that beats death, that beats fear. And it's our choice. We can let Jesus continue down the road as we go our separate way. Or we can invite Jesus into our lives, as the disciples did. And then a third thing happens in this story. And remember, the disciples still have not recognized that it is Jesus that is with them. They only recognize their risen Savior when they break the bread. When Jesus breaks that bread, in that instant, he disappears and they realize who he was, who he is. They finally get it. And I believe that in that moment of the breaking of the bread, in that instant that Jesus disappears, that all of that sadness, all of that fear that they had carried with them in that moment, in that travel from Jerusalem to Emmaus, in that instant, it is gone. And that fear, that sadness is replaced by hope, by faith. And so in this scripture, we see that the disciples and Jesus delve deep into scripture. Then the disciples invite Jesus into their life, into their home. And finally, they participate together in Holy Communion. And in that instance, after those three different events occur, Jesus reveals himself to the disciples and they see the truth. The truth of their risen Lord, and all the fear is gone. And so I want to end by letting you know that next week we will be participating together. We will be practicing Holy Communion together. And as strange as it sounds, we're going to be doing it through this streaming worship service through technology. So I ask that for next week, for next Sunday, that you prepare. That you and your families, or even if you're just by yourself, that you prepare by having some type of bread and some type of juice ready so that we can all practice and participate and experience Holy Communion together. I believe that it is extremely important for us to continue to do this even in this time. Remember that on that night in the upper room, Jesus didn't use some special bread or some special wine or juice. He was really just using what was on the table, just common things that they were eating and drinking. So you don't have to go out of your way or go to the store to get something special. Just use what you have at your home, have it ready, and we will do communion together. We will practice and live it together. Because we are still an Easter people, and we need to continue to experience our relationship with God. And that as we do this, the fear will be cast aside. Because God's hope, God's grace, God's love is greater than all of the fear. All of the fear that you can hear in the media, or the news, on the television, none of it can come close to what God and God's story for us is all about. So I pray you continue to join us. I pray that very soon we will be able to be together. I also just want to remind you to continue to be safe. Remember that being fearless does not mean being reckless. You need to continue to do the things that the government is telling us to do. Wear your mask, wash your hands, especially if you are sick or elderly or susceptible. Make sure you stay at home. If you have symptoms, stay away from other people, contact your doctor, go to the hospital. But do it without fear. Know that God loves you and God has a plan for you. God bless you and amen. Christ has gathered us together, together in hope, together in peace, together in faith, and together in love. And we are called to go forth and to spread that message of God's grace and love to the entire world. We are called to do this together as brothers and sisters in Christ. So go in peace and take the love and grace of God with you. Amen.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, the fear is gone. Because I worth the living just because he